sometimes.
I'll let you know.
Yes.
For all your creating and collaborating. So
I guess I can read the ritual panel description.
Okay.
In the New York Times, David Castillo and William Eggington opined, if the modern vampire may have functioned as an apt metaphor for the predatory practices of capital in colonial and post-colonial societies, today's zombie hordes may best express our anxieties about capitalism's apparently inevitable byproducts, the legions of mindless, soulless consumers who sustain its endless production, and the masses of human debris who are left to survive the ravages of its poisoned waste. How apt are these analogies? Are there other ways to link our modern capitalist practices to the creatures of horror and fantasy? And if capitalism is a horror story, do other economic philosophies offer more hope of a happy ending? That's the panel description.
I actually wanted to address that first question.
Great.
I agree. I think that, you know, vampires are sort of traditionally associated with aristocracy, right, in horror fiction and poetry. And so to transfer them then to the kind of, you know, the upper class, the 1% or whatever, still, you know, it makes some sense, right, to control of wealth. But it seems to me then that they're averse of that for the zombie is the fear of labor.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
It's the fear of the labor class. And since, you know, the zombie boom.
Okay, when you say the fear of the labor class, do you mean that other people, they're afraid of the labor class, or you think what the labor class is afraid of becoming?
Well, that's a good question. I'm not entirely sure what the answer to that is. I think that it can kind of be read both ways. I mean, zombies are such, by the way, super, I hate zombies, but. Represents so many different things. And I think if we look like George Romero's Day of the Dead, Dawn of the Dead, they certainly fit this kind of consumerist metaphor.
Yeah.
But I think the new boom in zombies is in part perhaps fueled by a 1% constructed narrative of the underclasses as a threat, in which the unemployed or the sort of the unwashed masses are a threat to our way of life. That's sort of the other side.
Well, that's sort of what. Yeah.
As opposed to consumers, they're more like the unemployed labor.
Well, that's the other half of this, the masses of human debris who are left
right,
behind.
Right, except that I think that when we put them into this idea that they're going to eat us, the survivor us, are the good labor, right? The people who work hard and buy into the dream and try to make their way up to middle class, you know, society, and that these are sort of the leeches on that.
Wow.
I
kind of
think it was a different kind of fear, in which the idea that people are afraid they are becoming zombies. So in most of the zombie narratives, there's a few survivors in there. But they're shooting heads off, they're throwing records, they're chomping dead. But they're always kind of winning. And I think people are like, they're afraid they're becoming that. They're afraid they're becoming an unwashed mass. And it's like, well, no, I don't have to be like that. I can be one of the tough guys. I think that they imagine themselves as winners.
Yeah, I guess one thing to ask is sort of who's the audience for the zombie story and how do they position themselves? Like, if they see themselves as the survivors, is that because they, if we're looking at this overall as this being a capitalism metaphor, are they survivors because they make their way from the collar to the middle class? That's the sort of success of the American dream, right?
There's also a sense of maybe that the zombie metaphor is the helplessness, that they're afraid they're going to become this, and after a while it's just luck whether you make it or not.
Yeah.
Because a lot of the zombie survivors.
zombies.
Or sympathetic.
The sympathetic zombies, yes, like exactly like iZombie. But also think about zombie walks. All the popular zombie walks in this country, people do not dress up as zombie slayers. They dress as zombies, and they get together and zombie walk.
Is that resting the narrative from the Hollywood?
I think it is.
Maybe just generally the poor, the poverty, is the danger being subsumed into that mass where you're not recognized as an individual, right?
The source of the analogy of capitalism and vampirism does come out of Karl Marx, and I just have to have it here. In Capital, in Das Kapital, this is the quote translated. Capital is dead labor that vampire-like only lives by sucking living labor and lives the more labor it sucks. The capitalist, the owner, is the vampire who will not lose his hold on the worker until he has sucked every drop of laboring blood. And then Marx goes on to say that capital itself is the undead, and vampirism is the signature disease of capitalism. Mm-hmm. So he's not only talking about aristocrats, like we think of like Dracula, but of the owners, the whole owner class. And what's interesting to me is I think that he came to it in those years of hanging out in the British Library reading, because in the Communist Manifesto of 1847, there is no mention of this analogy or in any of his earlier works. But by 1867 and Capital, he assumes the audience, he doesn't explain the analogy, he assumes the audience is going to understand what he means. And what came in between is not Dracula, but the novel of the most amazing multi-volume novel, Varney the Vampire, with his blood. And Varney, interestingly, starts out as middle-class factory owner and becomes ennobled, turns into an aristocratic vampire by the time he was lengthy serialized novel is finished. So I think that's what he was thinking of. And assuming, just like now when we say zombies, that people are not going to think of Haitian folklore, they're going to think of George Romero. I think that's what he was thinking about, precisely a factory owner who gets so rich that he becomes part of the aristocracy.
That's kind of ironic, don't you think? Because what they've discovered about the voodoo type zombie is they really were heat labor. They they thought they were dead zombies in order to get heat labor. So that's really, exactly. Are you getting better than that?
Well, and I think that metaphor of the aristocrat as bloodsucker, as leech, as vampire, is also used by Shelley.
Yes.
In England in 1819. I was just checking England in 1819.
Well, because the first literary vampire was by Polidori, coming out of that same circle.
And Keats, of course, has the Longyear.
Yes.
Right, as well.
Yeah. And it's interesting because before that, the folkloric vampire was decidedly not an aristocrat.
Right.
The folkloric vampire was like the was of the peasant class and had no glamour about it at all. But it would be—I've never been able to find somebody who could describe why overnight, thanks to Shelley and that circle, the vampire turned into the aristocrat.
Yeah, and of course, I mean, Shelley is this wild radical.
Yes.
Although from society, but is very much anti monarch, anti factory owner, right? Revolutionary. And he uses that metaphor in that poem and in others of the owners or aristocracy. Either one can be these sort of bloodsuckers. And it seems like the vampire never really goes back in kind of popular imagination to its common roots, right? It remains aristocratic.
And I think the aristocrat is interesting because, you know, you talk about why there's a particular circle who had noble backgrounds and blah, blah.
Well, Lord Byron had it first. I mean, yeah. Right, Polidori supposedly stole Byron's story.
Yeah.
Right.
But it's the, an aristocrat is a very tenuous kind of position. Yeah, you're the vampire, you're sucking the blood, but also you've got curious vulnerability to daylight. I think that makes me that kind of power was really precarious.
Yeah, although those, I think the weaknesses accrue
yes.
gradually over the course of the century in that those vampire stories.
Sure.
And it's not all at once.
That's for sure. Varney has a Varney can go out in the daylight, Polidori's vampire, who is the Lord Byron, can go out in the daylight. They're almost unbeatable.
Right,
yeah.
Right. And even so with Dracula, is far less bound by the rules of vampires that we the shadow of two sticks together can burn the vampire.
He has shape-shifting ability.
Yes.
This is just as kind of a very side note, when you're talking about the zombie walk, the best headline I ever saw in any newspaper was in the Salem News several years ago.
Oh.
And it was like, the police wary of Freeman zombies.
Police wary of Freeman zombies?
Attractive vampire. But vampires, you know, even in early film, you look at Nosferatu, he is not physically attractive in any way, but he is compelling, and this power to compel, this power to hypnotize or to command, that again seems very much sort of putting the figure of the that sort of the one who has control, right? Whether it's the aristocrat, you know, his count or off control.
Yes.
Or the even the factory owner.
Yes.
You know, that's the person who can tell you when you must rise and when you must sleep and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
And will take your children away from you.
Well, and you can put Nosferatu and Metropolis next to each other. And see lots of parallels. Oh, it looks like there are already some uprisings from the audience.
Actually, I always associate the zombies with the cubicle workers,
rather
than the common neighbor.
Oh yes, free your brains, Jeff Colton, Jonathan Colton.
Yeah, I think you can certainly read them that way. Again, and they can, because they're so malleable, you know, you can have them as that sort of utter representation of conformity.
Laborers are like strong, they have things to do for that shambling boars, shambling with their cubes, shambling out
of the evening. That scene in Shaun of the Dead where first scene everyone's kind of normal shambling, and the next they did repeat the whole scene, and now they're zombie shambling and can't really tell much
difference. Well, you know, it's interesting in looking at that, there is, of course, this is science fiction, but invasion of the body snatchers, right? Finney never says what his politics are, right? But it's very easy to look at the novel and say, okay, the aliens are either communists, infiltrators, or McCarthyites. Either direction. Are they saying, put away your emotions and don't think for yourself and don't be an individual? Or are they saying, you know, join the collective, right? And so are they McCarthyites or are they communists? But the 1978 Philip Kaufman film, which utterly brilliant movie, changed the setting, right? Not only in time, but in physical location. It's no longer a small town, it's San Francisco, right? The main character works for he's a government bureaucrat, right? He's a health inspector. And it suddenly becomes about urbanization. And it becomes about the loss of identity in the city. And there is this sort of parallel to the everyday worker, right? Who kind of, you know, if you've ever ridden the subway in New York or Boston in rush hour, and that stony face, don't make contact, I'm not really here.
The subway face.
You write, you know, you become that automaton, you become that alien, you become that zombie. So there's certainly that aspect of the workforce.
That's wonderful. You know, I just happened to pull a few academic articles about zombies. I actually used it as a handout in a composition class once, saying, hey, you can make arguments about anything. And the first one is zombie geographies and the undead city. I argue that for geographers, this is from a geography journal, okay? Zombie films can be read as expressions of a body's cities theory that emphasizes the role that spatial and bodily otherness plays in the constitution of bodies and cities. So you just managed to nail it right there.
Certainly, you know, we've seen that progression. I'm not saying that all of Romero's films are brilliant, but there is a progression in Romero's films to more and more urban environments, right? Where it goes from kind of a smallish town, really, or at least they're out of the outskirts of this town, to a shopping mall, and then into the more densely populated, and find the city of the dead to the fourth, right? And it's that film.
Yeah, that's the best way it gets to me. Writer, it's just the way it makes it scarier. Like, okay, as long as I stay away from the small town, I'm safe. Okay, I can stay away from the mall, I can stay away from mom, I'm safe. I can't stay away from the city.
Right, but and I think Romero also touches on what Stephen King does so effectively, which is take leaves the uncanny. He takes the familiar and defamiliarizes it or makes it threatening. And so, you know, your small town is supposed to be non-threatening, right? Or the shopping mall, this is where we all go, and we all, we're familiar with it. It's something we know the map, we have the map right there, in our heads. And now, it becomes the death, right? This is the place where we have to survive. And I think maybe as more and more population has moved to city, right? The urbanization, we also get that, then let's make that even better. Like, cities aren't growing enough. Let's fill in zombies.
Yeah.
Real zombies, not just
more alligators, obviously.
What's interesting, of course, actually, you could read the whole history of shopping malls in America through zombie films. It's hard to realize, but if you go and watch the original, the first Romero, Dawn of the Dead, as opposed to the later remake, shopping malls were still new. There's actually some info dumping early in that film of explaining what an incredible place this is, this huge mall that has all these stores and all these things.
Monroeville Mall, which has been in the news recently for riots.
Right, exactly.
There's our zombie mats.
Yes.
In there.
Yeah. But I figured a shopping mall would be a good place for zombies assimilated for a new mother. Because of the ADA, there's plenty of, accessibility.
Oh, yes.
They start all that after. They're not going to climb up the stairs. They have a chance. They need those escalators. They need those other things.
Well, so there...
Is that the secret agenda?
I think that's probably the
agenda. But they're early in the history of shopping malls. Today, or the other extreme, the malls are going under all the time. And every time a mall goes out of business, somebody says, it's a zombie mall now. And there's even a whole website called deadmall.com that has all these photographs of crumbling malls, the zombie malls.
And you brought up the remake of Dawn of the Dead, which actually begins in one of these kind of McMansion plans, subdivisions, right? And it does for sort of the new subdivision, kind of what Poltergeist did for the early 80s subdivisions, right?
So there's no doubt that not only is it an apt analogy, although not the only analogy, you said it at the beginning, I mean, zombies are so over-signified that a quick literature search, you can find at least 25 totally different metaphors for zombies in the first 25 things that pop up. But
did you run across anything related to 28 Days Later? Because that was sort of one of the kickoffs of the second zombie boom, sort of the 2001 to now zombie boom, and that film takes place in London. It's totally the urban zombie experience.
Yeah.
But that's also the fast zombie.
Yes, exactly.
That's why did the Shambling Dead zombie take over from the voodoo type zombie? That's not boring.
Oh, for two really good reasons I can think of right away. One is action films. There's,
I mean, not even speed, but why?
But the other half is plague. That the overwhelming metaphor in the 21st century, I think, for zombies has been plague.
Yeah.
That they just represent, they're not just the walking dead, they're the walking infected. They're the running infected. And plague, by its nature, is fast.
Yeah, and 28 Days Later, certainly, that's all about.
Yeah.
But Toni, you were asking more about how did it go from being the Haitian kind of zombie to Romero-ish
zombie. And that's
zombie.
Pretty much Romero.
Right.
He doesn't call them zombies.
No, he doesn't.
This is really about people's reaction to Romero. Sort of inflation in someone's mind.
He's not specific in Night of the Living Dead. There's just that sort of hand-waving, it was a radiation from outer space.
Yeah.
Right. But the rest... but they are still slow, shambling, undead, closer to the...
Yeah,
the
they are the dead coming back to life, which, and I think that, yes, you're right, it's sort of people talking about the film apply the Z word to them, and he doesn't use them until the second film.
Yeah, but then, as he went along, they got less and less like the folklore zombie, and they became the Romero zombie.
But I wonder, you know, is there something to do with, of course, his, that first film is very much about race.
Yeah.
But I wonder if there's also a shift away from that Haitian zombie as there's a more attentive sense of cultures, and the African-American is not just to be portrayed as either a keeper or a threat kind of thing, which you see in the 1940s.
Yes, white zombie.
That first white zombie.
Yes.
I think
one of the points is that the Haitian zombie is passive.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And the other kind of zombie is both mindless and aggressive.
Yes.
Right. Yeah, and there's not a third person controlling the contemporary zombie.
Right.
Right. You're right. The Haitian zombie. Somebody else is actually in charge of the zombie.
And in some ways, it's scarier or less scary because if you take out that guy, the zombie throw away.
Yes.
That seems to be the main story of the zombies.
What you were talking about with George Romero's intent with the that living dead, the original, and how that evolved in our reaction. Just remind me of a quote from him, which is how he said, "I always thought of zombies being about revolution, one generation consuming the next."
Whoa. Well, that's great.
Yeah, although, you know, if you think of revolution in a positive, I assume he's talking about it in a positive sense, I don't know that I want to be a revolutionary if it's a zombie, right? I mean, it doesn't seem like something aspirational.
Isn't the zombie being revolutionary, or the opposite?
That's just the quote, I don't know.
I would assume it's the zombies are the new generation who consume the old.
I thought it said one generation consuming the next.
Oh, was it then? Was
that's it that Jewish that could be interpreted, I guess.
Wow.
What about the man made of
the track science creature and that sort of thing?
Is that life more science?
Yeah, and I think there is a kind of, you know, I think you can map some sort of capitalist sort of construction and how what we build. I mean, this is in the original, right? Is very much a reaction to the Enlightenment, you know, the dangers of science, but that what we build can be the source of our destruction. But and read it in that way, where the scientist is the capitalist, his product becomes his doom.
And what you build suddenly has its own mind.
Right, right. Which may transfer into then, you know, AI type stuff.
So on the one hand you have goals. Another great favorite of mine. I do love golems. But the legend of the golem is a made creature that is reanimated mud. In many of the folk tales, it's not that they turn on their creator and rend their creator, it's that they can't be stopped. So many of the early golem stories are like the Sorcerer's Apprentice, which is inspired by one of them. You give the golem a command to draw water, and it draws water until the whole town, the whole shtetl is underwater. You give it the command to bake matzah for Passover, and it uses up all the flour for miles around and can't possibly stop. But there's the control is religious control. The name of God is on its forehead, or the name of God is on its lips, under its tongue, and the wonder-working rabbi who animated it can de-animate it. But the golem legend also evolved. Those were the folkloric stories. But when you get to the 19th century, you have all the pogroms in Eastern Europe, you have the rise of a literary constructed narrative that says, no, the golem was the protector of the ghetto and aggressive. And when Christians try to hide children that he discovered in the blood libel and so on, the golem would find the child and get rid of it. And all of those are not 16th, 15th century folklore. They're 19th century literature. literature that was disguised as, by setting it in the 16th and 17th century. There's the same sort of thing, that your creation can get away from you, or it can protect you,
right.
But one or the other.
Yeah.
There was a question here.
So, I was just wondering, one thing, interesting thing that zombies and vampires have in common, which a lot of other monsters do, is that they're both monsters that can turn you into one of them. Like a vampire can suck your blood and you can become a vampire, or a zombie can bite you and become a zombie. And that's not a feature a lot of other monsters have. And so I was wondering, do any of you have an idea of how that plays into zombies or vampires as class or capitalism metaphors?
Well, I think they're both fairly recent. In the folkloric vampire belief, right up through the 19th century, the vampire didn't turn its victim into another vampire. It turned its victim into a dead person. And that's why they were dangerous, because they could kill you, but they didn't turn you into another one like themselves. Whereas then in literature, in film, the whole trope arose that the vampire.
Is that a Stoker invention?
I think it is. I think it's one of Stoker's inventions. That it's much more interesting as a narrative. It's much more interesting. Rather than what could be more horrifying than just being, oh, it's a monster, it kills you. Oh, it's a monster, it turns you into something like itself. And then the zombie bite turning you into a zombie, again, is a plague narrative rather than anything out of folklore.
Okay, I'm spinning this out of hand, but here's my theory. So the use then by Stoker of this conversion,
yeah,
I think is maybe a way of illustrating the seductive quality,
yes,
right? That you can be then seduced into marrying into or aspiring to be that upper class, which changes you from being human.
Oh, that's true.
Yeah.
That's kind of neat.
Yes, exactly. You too will be a bloodsucker. And that is also perhaps the dangerous allure of capitalism.
Yeah.
That everybody wants to be a successful capitalist.
Right.
And
the vampire thing comes like marrying up and
right.
Girls
then.
Yeah. In Rhode Island,
you're
getting a mercy job.
Well, that's who I'm talking about.
But it was vampirism was connected with tuberculosis.
Yes.
And during that, a lot of people were terrified of the plague, that's how you turn into a vampire.
What's interesting is that in the 80s, there was a resurgence in interest in vampires, in part because they serve so well as a metaphor for STDs.
Yes.
Because they are seductive,
yeah,
and then you are infected.
And
then
the CDC,
there's
zombie
prep. Right.
Yes.
And that's and zombies are much more of a kind of, if you want to look at them in the disease, outside of the capitalist beginning, the disease thing, are much more kind of a good metaphor for things like Ebola and
yeah,
you know, those are contemporary diseases as opposed to STDs like AIDS. Whereas vampires are much more suited because honestly nobody wants to screw a zombie. But vampires are hot.
I've actually written quite a bit about the Rhode Island and Eastern Connecticut vampires, and yes, that's what I meant by saying that the folkloric kind of vampire belief lingered even in New England right to the end of the 19th century.
Did you just recently found a grave? I think it was in New England, where they, you know, dug it up and they found where the heads had been cut off.
Well,
fairly prime.
No, I think you're thinking of the outbreak, the excavation in 1991. I don't think there's been one since then, but I'll have to talk to her. For many years, in fact, even when I first started writing about this, there was some doubt about whether this belief might have been made up by Lovecraft. I mean, it was so outlandish, so incredible. But there, besides there being a lot of newspaper articles, in 1991, by mistake, an abandoned cemetery was cut into, and among the graves that they found was something that furthered the vampire belief. The only solution to these plague vampires is spread tuberculosis or consumption. literally, was to in some way disturb and kill the dead. So they found a grave where the body had been ripped into post-mortem, the ribs were scattered all around, clearly the heart had been taken out, and then the skull had been arranged, the bones had been recomposed as a skull and crossbones with the head turned down. And this was the first physical evidence, and it's true since then there have been, I know about the plague cemetery in Venice, where you might have heard where they found several skulls that had bricks shoved through the jaws, because the Italian belief was that the way that they were called shroud chewers. They believed that they could chew through their shrouds and come out and start spreading the plague again. It's a plague zombie slash vampire, and so you shoved a brick between the jaws and maybe it would stay put.
You wonder how many people caught Virgil from nothing with a dead body?
Well, of course they did. Every one of the stories, including Mercy Brown, this famous one, they're trying to save the last surviving brother, and they dig up all of the Brown family, decide that the sister, Mercy, was the vampire, do this burn her heart, recompose the body, rebury her, and of course, make a paste of the ashes, which they fed to the brother, who died shortly thereafter.
And they pick it up with coffee.
And the thing is,
so you're saying that their treatment was not really ready for clinical trial.
But the thing is that a number of these cases, the TB, these are small towns. It does burn itself out. Nobody even knows now why some people get it and some people don't, let alone them. So yeah, they would think it worked if only one or two more died.
Can you fit Richard Matheson I'm Legend into your scheme here?
Oh, that's great, because he's certainly part of that transition from small town to big city, because I'm Legend is Los Angeles originally, and from a folkloric explanation to a scientific explanation.
He's the first with the,
I think he might have been the first to
bacteria
to
mend
to use the bacteria causing this unknown disease.
I love coming up with theories at the spur of the moment. It's particularly alternative capitalism. They've consumed the entirety of labor and there's nothing left, and so they themselves are dying out because the aristocracy has nothing on which to feed it.
Parasite has killed its host.
Yeah.
Also, at least in the movie version, there's that kind of religious overtone.
Well,
and
he becomes a kind of messianic figure.
Yes. Yeah.
There is one working class vampire slash zombie.
Right.
Jesus.
Whoa.
Right. Because absolutely working class, communist. Really. But if you eat of my flesh and drink of my blood, then
it rises.
So,
Yes.
Just to defend everyone.
Person in the second row has been very patient.
I actually have two different things I'm trying to. Can I say both?
Sure.
Pick
sure.
Which one you want to comment on? One question I had was on the subject of. Other creatures, I was going to ask, what about the werewolf? And maybe there's a metaphor to be made about a creature who appears normal and benign, but is in fact a monster. And the other thing I wanted to say is when we were talking about the aristocratic vampire versus the common man vampire, I wanted to bring up the example of Buffy the Vampire Slayer, where you have, to those who are familiar, you have the juxtaposition of Angel or Angelus versus Spike, where Angel is the traditional aristocrat, or Angelus is the traditional aristocrat vampire, and Spike is kind of rebelling against that, and in intent, like he, before he becomes a vampire, is an aristocrat who intentionally adopts the behavior of the lower class.
Wow.
So I think that's an interesting comment maybe on the vampire genre as a whole.
Well, the werewolf thing is, that's a really hard question, because the werewolf is a world culture, or the transformation into the animal is a world culture phenomenon. And so it depends on where you look. I mean, there are certainly working class peasant folkloric transformations like that, you know, shamans and that sort of thing. But there are also aristocratic werewolves. There's a 12th century where the Les Esprits de France, Bisquare, is about a knight.
He's
a really good, in fact, his wife, who wants to leave him because he's a werewolf, is the evil person in the story. Because she breaks up the good love affair, because they love him. Really, and she's punished, and at the end, he, in werewolf form, bites off her nose, and then she marries this man that she cheated on him with, and all of their children lack noses, because that's how she acts. So, but Bisquare is an aristocrat. He's a good knight. He's good to his people, and yet, you know, 3 days. I think it's actually 3 days a week, not 3 days a month. So it's pretty frequent. He goes into the forest and takes off all his clothes and ties them in a stone next to a chapel. And does wild things in the woods. But if you read this really carefully, you can make a very strong argument that his werewolf nature is a symbol of his homosexuality.
Whoa!
There's actually a lot of evidence in the story that you can put together that, you know, he is doing all the right things as a knight, but this is a part of his nature to go off.
But still, they're not dead in the same way. I mean,
no, they're not.
They're
not dead.
No, and they don't turn other people into werewolves by biting them, because, of course, the wife just lacks a nose.
Right. But in modern werewolf stories, we do have that. Right?
Yes,
so
exactly
like the
same.
Thing.
Yes.
And again, you know,
the original Wolfman movie seems
right,
to be the origin.
But, you know, poor Larry in The Wolfman. He's a working class schlub, right? I mean, he's just a guy.
Yep.
He's not like he's not an aristocrat.
He's
his father. I thought that was the hammer.
No,
I
think
it's
the
early
one.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh yeah, Claude Rains. It's hard to make him a peasant.
That's true.
But in The Wolfen, Whitley Strieber's novel, there's a whole aristocracy of werewolves that have been around for thousands of years.
Yeah.
They're very much like vampires in some way.
Yeah.
Well,
Dracula could change into a wolf.
Very good.
Dracula was a werewolf. In the film.
If you read John Crowley's Egypt sequence, he uses the historical werewolves that are discussed by Carlo Ginzburg in The Night Battles. There was a strong tradition in Europe, in northern Italy and in parts of the Balkans, that werewolves were good people who changed into wolf form and detected and battled witches. And they went out to protect the crops in these night battles. Oh, thank you.
I brought my theremin.
Yeah. If you read John Crowley, he used that strand into the Egypt sequence. Good werewolves. And I think that Bisquare is part of that tradition. It's reflecting that folkloric tradition. So certainly, lots of things to do with werewolves. I haven't, Buffy, I think, is part of the, I think, really the first, again, eruption in the popular culture of not only sympathetic vampires, but vampires as really desirable boyfriends. And again, the same thing you see in Twilight, you see over and over again, the immortal boyfriend that, because the classic teenage romance story is, the attractive bad boy from a lower class background who doesn't fit the stereotype, but it's James pristine, wild one.
I don't think you could be much further over the wrong side of the track.
Exactly.
Than a vampire.
Yes. Well, that, no, that's just it.
Yeah.
That by the 80s and 90s and into this century, it's hard to find any human who would be as stigmatized as bad boys once were, when once upon a time just bringing home a boy from the lower class was enough to throw everyone into a tizzy. Mm-hmm. Now it has to be a vampire or a werewolf.
No, so it's at least with vampires, it's an older man.
Yes.
Well, I don't know.
Just
16, 200, that's a little creepy. But there's sort of that, it's heavier Haringa too, isn't it? Because he's a vampire, so he's a bad boy. He's a vampire, so there's an aristocratic quality to him as well. So he's a high class bad boy.
Yeah.
He's a bad boy who knows how to dress.
He's jointed, but he doesn't want to.
He plays much younger.
Well, we didn't talk about Elizabeth Thatcher.
Oh, that's right. The blood count.
Sort of
yeah.
Well, we I think we kind of maybe focus on the male vampire.
That's right.
I wonder about the female vampire. I mean, obviously, she's an actress.
Yes.
But there are, there's Trousseau.
Stars in silent films were called vamps.
Yes.
And those ladies were younger. So we could end up thinking about, again, a positive association, but with the old kind of negative associations
right.
going
and
on.
And pizza's love you.
Yes.
Right, so
yeah.
We're out of time.
We're out of time? Oh no!
Okay.